that we all live on. This is, well, it's December 6th, and it's the first Sunday of the month. So that means it's PPG World Service Day, and we have a great show lined up for you today. I do want to add that this show is sponsored by Sitstay and the Climb, which is a Blue Nine pet product. Sitstay and the Climb were two of the sponsors at the 2015 PPG Educational Summit. So without further ado, let's get this party started. Hi Louise, where are you? Are you here?
I'm here, Niki. Well, I'm not quite there. I'm not quite with you. I'm in Spain. I can't say sunny Spain. It's rather cloudy today. And it's a good evening, actually, from me, because we're now in the evening. So you've got the day ahead of you, and ours is just coming towards the end.
Fabulous. Well, the weather here is actually beautiful. It's a very typical December in Florida. It's about 75 degrees, so it's just absolutely fabulous. I don't know if Morag, one of our guests on the show today, has been affected by all the dreadful rain that's taking place in the UK right now. I was watching it on the news this morning, but they have got some awful flooding up, well, not up there. I think it is up there. I think it's in the northwest, but yeah, and I know the northeast of the US is pretty cold as well, because I've been checking the weather, because I'm actually heading to New York tomorrow. So yay, we've got people from everywhere, which is a great reflection of PPG as an organization. So who is on our show today? Who's coming on?
Oh, wow, we've got some great guests today. As you just mentioned, we've got Morag Heirs on, and she's going to be chatting about all sorts of different things with us. We've got Daniel Antolec on, who's the chairman of the PPG Advocacy Committee. And we've got Jill Breitner. So a really packed show. So we better get on with it, Niki.
I know, Louise and I end up bantering about all kinds of nonsense, so, and that's probably why our show always runs over. So, yeah, so let's bring Morag on. So, Morag, welcome to the show. Thank you for joining us.
Hi, thank you very much for inviting me.
You're welcome. I know many of our PPG members will be very familiar with your name because of the great articles that you do in Bucks and the Guild. So I'm going to hand it over to Louise because I know she's got some great questions for you.
Hi, Morag. How are you?
Hi, I'm very good. I am also in the dark and the wet and the rain over here.
Oh, lovely. Isn't it nice to sort of live on the wrong side of the Atlantic, should we say? Okay, well, I'd like to start actually by just telling everybody just a little bit about you. You're a companion animal behaviour counsellor. You run Well Connected Canine in York, and that's in England, for anybody that hasn't worked out that you're from England. You work with deaf and blind dogs professionally, as well as obviously hearing and normal sight dogs. You provide training and support for the Deaf Dog Network, and you're the behaviourist, I think, for Sheffield Animal Shelter, and I think for York and District RSPCA branches. Maybe you can tell me whether I'm correct with that, Morag.
Yeah, you're absolutely spot on with all of that. I set up Well Connected Canine, but we now have another trainer and behaviourist, and we have another new trainer starting with us in January. And that's basically, like you say, because we're doing a lot of work with rescue organisations and we're covering most of North Yorkshire, which is a pretty big area for anybody that knows the UK. So yeah, we do a lot of driving, a lot of visiting different shelters and trying to provide information and education as much as we can.
Wow, great stuff. And I've actually, just the same as Niki, I've actually seen quite a few of your webinars, which are absolutely amazing. And I know that you keep up to date with all your training. Why do you actually think that it's important to keep up to date with, and I'm going to say non-confrontational, rewards-based, force-free training?
I guess the obvious reason is because we're always learning and there's always new stuff coming through. And I think the more detailed explanation is that my background originally is in psychology, so learning theory for humans and animals. And one of the things that was really clear when I started out in my original undergraduate honours degree is that we were at the cutting edge. We were being told things in our lectures and being told, last year we didn't know this was true about the brain. Last year we didn't know how plastic it was, how amazingly adaptable it was. And next year we'll probably have a whole new level of understanding about what we're capable of. So I think basically that was a really good grounding for me, and I think that remains true throughout all of my canine related work as well, is that I would never assume that I know it all. Obviously there's loads of stuff I can still learn, because we all can, but most importantly we're still learning how some of the techniques that we use actually work. And if we can really understand what the really active elements are, say in a whole training package, we can probably make ourselves more efficient. We can probably have a bigger positive impact on the animals and their guardians in less time, using less complicated explanations, when we really drill down to why it is that giving the piece of food at that particular point in, say, a counter conditioning program actually works the way we think it does in the brain.
What a great answer. Yeah, absolutely. And you just mentioned actually something interesting, that you've got a degree, I think you've got a master's actually, haven't you, in psychology and a PhD. How important do you actually think it is for, sorry, carry on.
Sorry, I you were going made to say a mistake over the time delay.
That's okay. How important do you think it is for dog trainers and other pet care professionals to actually have an understanding of the science behind the training?
I think it's really important, but I'm going to qualify that answer, because I think it depends partly on what it is that you're doing and what your role is. So within the UK, there's moves towards regulation with the Animal Behaviour Training Council, ABTC, one of the many alphabet soups we have around just now. And one of the things that I think they're actually making a really good point with is they distinguish between a kind of a behaviour technician, so someone who's really involved in the day-to-day support, the helping to tweak the owner's kind of handling and timing, but they're not necessarily the person who've devised the overall plan, who've gone through the medical differentials, who've looked at all the contributing factors and kind of really drilled down to what the core, say, emotional distress is. So I think it's really important for both groups of people to understand why they're doing what they're doing, because they need to be able to ask good questions like, why are we doing that now rather than in 2 months' time? And why are we putting in the animal or the person in this particular situation? But in terms of the depth of understanding and the level of academic qualifications that might be required, I think that should be tailored to the level of responsibility and the extent to which you're either implementing a training plan or a behavior modification plan versus you're doing the research to create the plan tailored to the dog's specific condition. So there's a lot of arguments in the UK about this move towards, say, that all behaviorists and anyone who wants to work in behavior should have a master's degree in animal behavior. And for a lot of people, that's too academic, it's too technical, and it doesn't fit what they're good at. And actually, a good regular degree in the animal behavior and training would be more than enough. So I think it's really important that we understand why we're doing what we're doing, but the actual level of academic qualification should match the level of responsibility that I think you have in your day-to-day role.
I think that's an excellent answer.
Another great answer.
Yeah, that's an excellent answer. I mean, I know over here, well, say over here in the US, and I know personally, my own opinion, there is a difference between a dog trainer and a dog behavior consultant in terms of the work that's being done and the academic knowledge that I feel that is required. But ultimately, and I think maybe this also speaks to what you said, I mean, ultimately, within our area of competency, irrespective of what our academic qualifications are or how good we are as a practical trainer, because I think for me the scary thing is when people start stepping outside their own areas of competency, and that's not good for our industry at all.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, one of the things that I do but my colleagues in my own business wouldn't do is I will also look at, you know, levels of physical tension. I might use some massage therapy or some acupressure based interventions and teach the owners how to do that. Now, that's because that's an area that I've done other training in. I've been a practitioner within humans, and then I retrained to study in animals. and it's not something that I do as my sole focus, but if it's appropriate, say a noise sensitive dog, then I would absolutely add that in. It's not something that I would expect my colleagues to be doing, because even though I do it, they haven't done the extra training. So they would always say, huh, I think this would be useful. How about we schedule a session with Morag and she can add that into your program? And, yeah. And that's the way it should work, is you know where your areas of strengths are and where you're insured to work, frankly, and you stick within that, or you learn more so you can expand.
Right, right. And I think you're right, because I think it doesn't just look at whether someone's a trainer or a behavior consultant, because for me the fundamental difference is I speak to dog trainers that don't really have any understanding of Pavlovian conditioning, they don't have a functional assessment, they're not sure how to write a behavior change program. And for me, that if you're lacking that level of knowledge, then you should be focused primarily on just sort of the constructional approach, sort of helping an owner with, you know, training some pet dog manners with a dog that doesn't have any problematic emotional responses or there's no fear or aggression there. But I think it also works as well across the different dimensions, because there are so many specialities now. I mean, there's, you know, resource guarding, there's aggression, there's reactivity, there's separation anxiety. And I consider myself a fairly well-rounded professional, but if there's a professional in my area that works predominantly with, you know, reactive dogs, I'm going to refer out, because if that's their expertise, that's where I think the client should go. And I don't think any of us, however experienced we are, can be experts at every single thing within our industry. You know, in the medical industry, that's not even the case. And I think it most definitely applies to our industry too.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think it also goes the other way, because there's certainly here in the UK, we are seeing some people graduating from even master's level programs, although I would perhaps quibble as to the academic standard, but they're coming out with a master's of science in, you know, animal behavior or animal counseling, and yet they have very little practical experience. So in theory, they know how to write a training plan to work through something like separation anxiety, except they've never done that. And if they're presented with a dog that doesn't walk to heel, they don't have the tools in their toolbox to be able to work on that very practical element either. So yes, we want to have academic standards, but just in the same way we've seen a lot of debates around nursing qualifications, we need to make sure that the academic knowledge is balanced with the practical experience, and that kind of, you can just instinctively do what you need to do and then explain it to your client.
Absolutely. I mean, yeah, I couldn't agree more. I mean, you know, we all know there's so many examples of well-schooled individuals that don't have the mechanical competency, and there's also a lot of mechanically competent trainers that can't necessarily articulate why they're doing what they're doing, or, you know, what's actually happening in terms of sciences. So it works, you know, it works all ways, doesn't it?
Absolutely.
I mean, you know, mental health, we have, it's like, you know, we have what's the three? We have sort of social workers, then we have, you know, clinical nursing, and then we have actual, you know, doctorates. And I think in our industry there is a place for those different levels, as long as we all know what we're doing and we all work together well. I think that would be far more beneficial to our pet dogs.
Yeah, absolutely. And it would also then mean that those people who are darn good at what they do but have no particular interest or don't have the kind of learning style that goes well with difficult academic qualifications or sitting and writing a thesis, that they wouldn't then be excluded from an industry where they have a huge amount to offer, actually.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. And I think that's one of the fears, particularly over here, and I'm sure it is in the UK. I'm not on the ground there, but I know here one of the fears is that if we don't do something as an industry ourselves to regulate how we operate as an industry, at some point government intervention will come. And when government intervention comes, if it does come, I don't think it bodes well for any of us, because you then have a third party that doesn't necessarily understand putting artificial restrictions on what people can do and how they can do them. And like you say, I mean, I know some really good dog trainers that have no interest in working with behavior, so to speak, but they just do an absolutely brilliant job at, you know, churning out puppy classes and pet dog obedience classes. And we need them. We need them in the industry. I mean, there's a lot of that that's needed, versus the sort of behaviorist types that are working more with, you know, maybe a combination of pharmacological intervention and other components. So, yeah, and that's one of the reasons why I think as an industry we need to be at the forefront and looking at how we do control ourselves rather than, you know, a third party pushing that control down on us.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, Louise, over to you.
Definitely. Great discussion there, actually. That's really interesting, because I totally agree. I think To be honest, I think trainers do need a certain level of knowledge. I think there are people out there calling themselves trainers, and they're actually not only lacking in any scientific knowledge, they're also rather lacking in the mechanical skills as well. But I think, yeah, self-regulation is definitely the way to go if it can be done. I think that's the problem at the moment. There's no regulation, and therefore you've got people out there with very little skill and very little knowledge.
It has been done very successfully in a couple of other industries. I think one of them is the paragliding industry. Or is that a paragliding or microlight? I always forget. And they actually, rather than have the FAA mandate their safety and their compliance and their regulation, they actually created their own systems and have managed it so well that the FAA has stayed out of it. So there are examples of how it's been done before. There are. And I just want to go back on a point that both of you touched on, which makes my blood boil, but it also frightens me to death because I do a fair amount of business consulting with pet professionals, and I speak to people that have, you know, been to a very basic college, have less than a year of experience, but actually believe, and they believe this because as part of their educational system, they were told it, that they are fine dealing with dog aggression. And it's just, you know, I mean, it's not just about the academic qualification, it's about how much actual hands-on experience do you have? You know, and it's actually quite scary, it really is, and I really feel for the dogs because not only are they probably not getting the results, but I'm sure there's many dogs being put in situations that are just absolutely unfavorable and unfair because the practitioner does not have the experience. And I think back to when I started 14 years ago, I was very careful with what cases I took on, but I can also remember a couple of situations that I did take on when I realized very quickly I was completely out of my depth and had to get somebody else involved. And I fear that a lot of newer and less experienced trainers won't necessarily get somebody else involved. They just sort of struggle through it.
Yeah, I think as well it's that practical experience of working through with the dog and the client in front of you and learning how to adapt and tweak things. So you need to have that understanding of the principles so you're not breaking the system, as it were. But then it's that being able to adapt rather than just deliver a standard protocol, because the thing is they probably don't work for very many, if any, dogs or people. And at the point where someone's taken the time, the effort, and made the huge commitment to actually contact a pet professional to ask them for help, if it doesn't work out, what I see is that's kind of, they go, oh, well, I tried and it didn't work. So they think they have to live with this terrible situation. And if they contact someone again, it might take them 5 or 6 years. And then you're going, oh, Lord, now we've had 5 or 6 years of the problem getting even worse.
Mm-hmm, exactly. Well, and the other fear for me is that as sort of force-free, reward-based trainers, we're ambassadors for our philosophy and our methodology. And if we're dealing with clients and we don't have the skills and we're working outside our competency and they don't get the results, then my fear is where is their next port of call? It's probably going to be to trainers that are offering, you know, quick solutions through the use of aversive stimulation and or, you know, shock collars, etc. And that for me is far, far worse than the owners just saying, well, I'll just kind of live with it. You know, it's you know, we're dealing with living, breathing animals that have the potential, or not have the potential, but carry lethal weapons in their mouth, and we have to be highly responsible with that.
Agreed.
Oh, trials and tribulations of working in an unregulated industry.
Right. Well, I'm going to actually change the subject slightly now, guys, because Morag has got a particular interest in working with blind and deaf dogs, and I'd like to know, Morag, whether it is very different working with blind and deaf dogs. For example, if somebody was introducing a blind or deaf dog into their family, would they introduce it in the same way as a normally sighted dog, or would there be something in particular that you'd recommend them to do? What would the first steps be that you'd recommend to somebody?
Oh, big question. So assuming that the dog doesn't have any kind of major issues as such, other than, you know, they maybe don't have all of their senses available to them, then I would say that the prerequisite would be that you need to know that the dog is comfortable being touched. because touch is going to be a really important interrupter or a redirect signal, whether the dog is deaf, blind or both. It's something that you're much more likely to use, you're much more likely to need to be hands-on, and I mean that in the good way, not the bad pushing their bum down and shouting at them way. And so it basically just means if you're introducing that dog who has those visual or sensory impairments, then the person who is in charge of the dog, whether that's the rescue centre representative or whoever it is going to want to be fairly close to the dog so that they can help to supervise. Because what we've seen both with our own dogs, so I have a deaf collie and a deaf, mostly blind collie. My partner in business has a completely deaf, blind collie and a just deaf one that we got as a puppy together. What we see is that they are likely to miss some of the more subtle signs of communication. And what you don't want in those first few meetings between people and dogs or dogs and dogs is for that misinterpretation to lead to stress or tension or set up any unwanted kind of patterns of interaction. So the deaf dog may have perfectly good vision, but obviously unless they're actually looking and able to see in their peripheral vision, they may miss the very subtle low grumbling, growling, or this, you know, all of those little signs and all the rest of it. So that's where you'd want to be able to step in to know that if you tap the dog, or if they were a blind dog and they don't notice the silent lip curl, for example, that if you clap your hands, they know that they're going to reorient to you. You can move them out of the situation a little bit, let everything calm down, and then have them go back in again. So I guess making sure there's no other major issues, have that easy, quick way of redirecting, and be prepared to do a bunch more supervision than you might do with a normally sighted and hearing dog.
Cool. So it's basically about establishing some sort of line of communication with the dog, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And the thing is, my experience both with my own dogs and also with helping clients and doing the support work for the Deaf Dog Network is very much that actually once you've got a line of communication, it's really, really easy, because the majority of these dogs are actually very proactive in wanting to build a relationship and communicate. Where there's been a block or where it's been difficult, it's just because they haven't had a good way of doing that. So the look on a deaf dog's face is absolutely gorgeous when you see them responding for the first time to sign language, and you get the feeling that they've been waiting for this. They've been like, come on, speak to me, people. I just don't understand what you want from me.
I can envisage that. That must be wonderful.
I mean, I took one of my deaf dogs. We went to a fundraiser, which was actually a fundraiser for hearing dogs for deaf people. But we were there with a deaf dog, and we did a demo in the ring, and then there was a crowd of people there who were all deaf who really wanted to meet Farah. Now, obviously, she doesn't speak their complicated level of sign language, but she sat in the group of people who were signing away at her, and she was just looking from person to person, and her head was looking really chirpy and just wagging her tail, and she was like, I don't really know what you're saying, but I love that you're trying to talk to me. And I think that's really important, is to get that communication line open, like you said, and then be consistent with it.
Morag, you've actually left me there with a great big smile on my face and envisaging that. That must have been an absolutely amazing thing to see.
It was glorious. It was a highlight for both of us.
Are you a fan of the vibration collars for deaf and blind dogs?
No, not really. I think they are, in theory, a really useful idea, and I do know other people who use them quite successfully. My issue is that a lot of the people we see on the Deaf Dog Network, for example, is that their first thought is, oh my God, my dog is deaf and I didn't realize, I need a vibrating collar, otherwise I can't communicate with them. And those of us who've lived with deaf dogs for a bit longer are kind of like, well, actually, what you need to do is teach a good relationship, teach an automatic check-in, teach a solid recall signal when the dog is checking in with you visually. And if you go straight to a vibration collar, we tend to see that people skip those stages. So what happens if the collar runs out of batteries or malfunctions? You know, you don't have that solid grounding anymore. My other concern with the vibration collars, because it rains a lot here and I have dogs that like to go in the water a lot, is it's very difficult to get a good quality vibration only collar. So I'm concerned about then getting wet, going in the river, going in the sea, whatever.
Right, right. That makes a lot of sense. And I think as well, and I don't know how easy it is here, but I've heard people say here that it's very difficult to get them without having the shock component, and you know, therefore you're putting a tool in someone's hands that you really don't want them to use.
Yeah, I mean, there's a couple of models now available. One of them's cheap and cheerful, and one of them's more expensive, but they're kind of your only two options. They're pretty chunky. So again, if you've got a smaller dog, I can see how they would find that a bit invasive. And there are also, I mean, obviously I don't recommend this, but there are people who will use the spray collars as well, and they turn the jet so it's spraying onto the chest rather than under the chin. And their feeling is that if it doesn't bother the dog, then that's a perfectly adequate tool to use to get the dog back. I just think there are too many potentials for it going wrong, and I'm not convinced that it's non-aversive to dogs, frankly, even when the owners think they are. But the bottom line is, your dog needs to have all of those skills anyway. If you then add in an extra tool, then okay, we can see what would work best for you and your pet. But if your dog doesn't know that they need to check in with you every, say, 30 to 40 seconds, then you don't actually have reliable communication, and you can't then let that dog off lead, whether they've got a vibe collar on or not.
Right, right, exactly. Yeah. Wonderful.
And is there anything you'd actually recommend, Morag, to somebody who'd got a dog in their family already, but the dog is actually starting to go deaf or blind, perhaps due to old age? Is there anything that you could sort of say that would make the transition easier for those people? Would it be exactly the same, establishing that line of communication?
I think if the dog is going deaf, then the first thing to do would be to check as a family what hand signals you already use without realizing. So, you know, all those little things you do with your hand to tell when you're telling them to sit or lie down or whatever, that actually we probably don't realize we're doing. So for a lot of the basic stuff, people worry that they're going to have to teach them a bunch more hand signals, when in actual fact the dog already knows them. Making sure that the check-in is very reliable, because that's probably not in place unless they've done a lot of basic work. And then the last thing would be to make a big deal about learning a very obvious recall signal, because people who don't have deaf dogs don't generally learn that you have to jump around and wave your arms. We call it colloquially waving loudly. So you're gesticulating in an obvious way, doing high fives if you need to, star jumps, so that the dog realizes, oh, you needed me back. I think the thing, if the dog is starting to go deaf with old age, is to then make sure that they aren't also experiencing some visual impairment, because a lot of times, just like with everything else, dogs will compensate so very well that we actually don't realize how much they're losing some of those senses. So it's not uncommon for a pair of older dogs, one of them dies, and that's when the owner discovers, oh, actually, this dog can hardly see or can hardly hear. It's just that they've been following their family member. So that's kind of covered it up. And we always want to know what their abilities actually are.
Awesome. Some really good tips there. Thank you, Morag. Changing the conversation again slightly, you're a regular contributor to Box from the Guild magazine. In your article, It's All in the Management, in the May edition, you mentioned that in the UK you're seeing an increasing number of deaf Staffordshire Bull Terriers. You also mentioned American Bulldogs and Jack Russell Terriers in rescue shelters. Now, I've got a little Staffordshire Bull Terrier. I just wondered, are these breeds generally more affected by deafness, or are the numbers simply due to the fact that there are more of these breeds being surrendered?
Excellent question. I can't answer it completely off the top of my head, because I'd need to go back and look at my stats. The thing is that the numbers we have in terms of proportion of deafness in specific breeds, a bunch of that information comes from the USA, where there are different breeds recognised, and they are not necessarily the same as the breeds we would have similar names for, say, in the UK. So that definitely complicates things when we're trying to work out which breeds are prone to deafness or not. In terriers, I think it is actually, it's being acknowledged as more of a problem now, but within the UK there's a lot of kinds of terriers which aren't officially recognised by the Kennel Club, so that again makes it really hard to collect the information on them. In terms of Staffies and American Bulldogs, they're certainly, they're one of the breeds that would turn up in the lists, especially American Bulldogs, that we know there is a tendency, there is a risk of deafness, depending on the breeding. But within the UK, I think we're seeing more of it in rescue shelters because we're seeing a bigger portion of those dogs handed in. So at the two main rescues that I do work for, at least half of our population at any given time is bull breeds or bull breed crosses. And even the smaller rescues like Jerry Green that I've done some stuff with, we had a chat a year ago. They said they wanted me to come speak at their staff conference, but I needed to do something that wasn't the deaf dog thing because they didn't really get enough deaf dogs in. In the last year, I think they've had 8 in one centre. They're a small centre that only ever has, you know, 12 or 14 dogs in at a time. So that's actually pretty high given the previous year, I think they had 1. So I think it's a mixture of answers. Sorry.
never as simple as we'd like to think, is it?
No.
that's probably what I thought though, because I knew, for example, that in the UK there is a big problem with, for example, Staffordshire Bull Terriers in rescue shelters. You know that there's an awful lot of them. I'd also heard that there was, an increased incidence of deafness. It was just, the correlation between the two things. Cool. Okay. Right. What led you actually to take a particular interest in hearing and sight impaired dogs, Morag?
I went looking for my second rescue dog. My first rescue dog was a big tricolour border collie, mostly black and white. And one of the things that we were still working through was his noise sensitivity. He had some quite extreme noise phobias, among some other issues. And we'd gotten to the point where we were doing pretty well. We were making slow progress with the noise phobias, but I knew I could not risk bringing another dog into the family who would be nervous about noises, because I didn't want to make, obviously, Finn any worse, but I also couldn't countenance the idea of accidentally causing it in another dog. And I know it's very unlikely, but it's such a horrendous thing to live with for both the owner and the dog. I didn't want to do it. So I went to a border collie specialist rescue, said, here is me and my dog. This is the list of all the things we're still working on. We'd like to find a 3 to 5 year old boy collie companion for him to, hang out with. And I met some of the dogs and it just wasn't quite right, wasn't gelling. And then at the end of my second visit, they said, oh, we've got this little girl collie. And I went, uh-huh. I said, well, the thing is, we thought she'd be perfect. Why is that? Because she's completely deaf. And I went, oh, it hadn't even occurred to me that a deaf dog would in some ways be the perfect answer to what I needed. So on April Fool's Day, I ended up coming home with a 7-month-old female completely deaf border collie, as you do. So it was pretty much Farah that kind of threw me in at the deep end, and we experienced a lot of interesting reactions. A mixture of people who were kind of really keen to help us devise and come up with alternatives in training classes, and some other people who genuinely treated her and to some extent me as though we were slow and had kind of learning difficulties. And we didn't get on so well with that attitude, so I guess it spurred me on to find out more and help to show that actually deaf dogs are just as capable. Really, it's just that they can't hear with their ears. It's not such a big deal.
Good for you.
And she's still with me. She is, in fact, lying on her futon, staring at me pointedly.
Good for you. Yeah, I love that attitude. It's, when I first started dog training, even when I first had my very first dog, it was in the days when there was only about 3 books available, and one's a new Skeet, Brian Killamore, and one other. I just thought, I'm not teaching my dog anything like that. If that's the case, she can just be a scoundrel for the rest of her life. and then realizing that was completely unrealistic, I thought, there's got to be another way. And that was when I first started to learn about dog training, because I wasn't okay with the options that were available.
Yeah, absolutely. And it was that kind of, I don't really see why I shouldn't be able to do all this stuff. I can't see why it would be a problem. So right. We kind of went ahead and did it anyway.
Yeah, good for you. Good for you. Well, Morag, I'm going to be in the UK in June or July of next year, and I would love to come spend some time with you. So I'm going to hassle you a little bit nearer the date.
Perfect. Look forward to it.
See if I can head up to your part of the world.
Absolutely. That sounds really good. Thank you ever so much for today, guys.
Oh, you're so welcome. Morag,
how can people get in touch with you, Morag?
Best way of getting in touch with me is probably through the website wellconnectedcanine.co.uk. There's a contact form at the bottom of that, and that'll get picked up and bobbed over to me.
And right now we are showing on the screen your company logo and a nice picture of you and a little bit of information. So people who watch the recording will also be able to see that. So wonderful. Well, thanks a lot, Mara. We really enjoyed having you.
Thank you ever so much. Have a good night, guys.
You too.
Thanks. You too, Morag.
Bye.
Okay, Niki. I've now got a question for you.
Woo-hoo.
It's not been long since the summit. I want to know what happened at the summit. Now, I was there, so obviously I saw quite a lot of what happened, but there are a lot of people who'll be listening who unfortunately perhaps weren't able to attend. So can you give us the lowdown?
Well, we probably need a whole show, but in a paragraph, it was phenomenal. It was so much fun. It was so enriching to be around so many people that could share so much knowledge and so much experience, and people that philosophically were all just so wonderfully aligned. So it was an amazing experience. I personally did not get to see one session. I did try to attend two and had to leave them within 10 minutes. But I did speak to hundreds of people that thoroughly enjoyed it. We got some fantastic feedback from our survey that was sent out. And we had people like Pat Miller saying it's the best conference I've ever been to. So I think all in all, we did. The team of people that put this together and spent so much time, and the input from our sponsors and our vendors and our members and our steering committee and our board of directors and everyone that came out to the event, just massive thank you, because without everyone's contribution, it could not have been such a phenomenal and fabulous and uplifting and mentally enriching event. So it was just wonderful.
It really was. I've got to say, I had the best time ever. You know, we worked pretty hard, but we also played hard. There was lots of fun as well as the education. Met some amazing people. It was really nice, actually, to meet some of the people that we'd spoken to on the show, and I'm sure that, you know, you've spoken to via email or in webinars and things like that, wasn't it, to actually get to know them personally?
Well, yeah, and it was like my comment to Morag earlier. I was hugging people and kissing people as if they were long-lost friends and family, because you've seen their names for so long and you've emailed them and listened to webinars that you truly think you know them. And there they are, suddenly, a physical body in front of you, and you just think, oh my goodness, it suddenly occurred to me, I've never met you before. And it's actually quite a strange experience, because there's such a level of familiarity there. So I think that's one of the things I love so much about PPG, because you really do feel that it's just this huge extended family, and that's just such a wonderful feeling, and the atmosphere was fabulous. And for those of you that do not know, and well, you don't know except for a few of us, we actually had decided a month before the summit not to do a summit in 2016, that we were going to do a virtual summit. And it was, I believe it was at one of the functions that some of the team leader committee sort of looked at me and said, do you honestly think we're going to get away with not having one next year? And I just looked and said, no, we don't, because everybody was, okay, where is the venue for next year? Which has actually meant that coming off the back of that summit, I spent the last week and a half scrabbling around looking for a hotel and a location, because it had not been in our initial plan. We'd actually planned to do a virtual summit in 2016 and then 2017, do a summit in both the British Isles and Australia and the US. So anyway, we are now having a physical summit in 2016. It was such a great event, and we received so much feedback, and everyone, I mean, when I mentioned to a few people that we weren't sure if we were planning on having one, the horror on their faces was enough said. So we are, so obviously now we are doing a summit, and save the dates, November 7, 8, 9, and 10 will be the dates for the summit in 2016. So save the dates. There will be an email going out in the next couple of weeks. And actually, I'm sitting here with right now. With
and the, where will the summit be then, Niki?
It's going to be
in the same place in Tampa.
It's not going to be the same location, but it is the same place. We're doing it in Tampa for a couple of reasons. One, because at this point in time, I don't feel we have the funds or wouldn't necessarily want to waste membership funds on paying a conference organizing company to do that. And because I'm located here, it makes it very easy logistically to get everything sorted. And I think that's one of the reasons why the event was so good last year, because it, many people commented on how well organized it was. And I think that was one of the reasons for that, I do believe, is because of, you know, us being on site made it very easy to make sure that everything went off very smoothly. So again, we'll do it in Tampa next year, and then in 2017, we will look at maybe taking it on the road. So yeah, very exciting stuff.
Awesome, and we don't need an event organizer when we've got you to do all the running around anyway, Niki.
Well, thank you so much for that, Louise. I do want to just take this time just to plug our 16 summit, because you would not believe some of the speakers that we have got lined up, and I can't at this point say anything, but there are a couple of people that you will, not you personally, Louise, but everybody will just be absolutely fascinated with. It's massive, massive names in the industry. So, and there's a lot of other stuff coming from that. And then we're hoping to have some off-site workshops as well. So I think 2016, it will be bigger and better and more fun. We're not aiming for something that's tremendously large, because I think then I think one of the great things about the summit this year was the intimacy. I think, you know, having just a few hundred people there meant that people actually could get to know each other. And I think maybe you lose that when you get into sort of the 900,000 people. So, yeah, but who knows? Who knows what will happen? Who knows what's in the future?
Hey, who knows? But I do agree with you, actually. It was really nice because obviously there were a lot of people there, but the numbers weren't so high that you felt that you couldn't, you know, say hello to people, and there were lots of sort of great conversations going on over the dinner table and over a few glasses of wine, etc. Yeah, it's absolutely fantastic experience. And if next year is even just on the same level rather than better, you know, it will be an amazing experience. It's something that, you know, you don't forget, do you?
No, absolutely. Especially with it being the first one, I think it was very special because it was the first one. I mean, you know, I don't cry very often, but I cried several times over the space of those 3 or 4 days. It was very emotional as well. It was, you know, a lot of hard work, but not just the hard work at the summit, but just, you know, PPG starting and, you know, growing and becoming viable and becoming an organization that we now know has longevity and is impacting the industry. And I think the summit was sort of the pinnacle of all of that. So I think for a lot of people, there was a lot of emotional energy there as well, which was really nice to see. And people are just so invested in the organization. They're really engaged, which is nice. And we want the membership to be engaged. It's their organization. We want to know from them what we're doing well, what we're not doing well, what they'd like us to do. Because again, it's a member organization and it needs to meet the needs and the goals of the membership. So yeah, it was a lot of fun. It was wonderful.
Yeah, definitely. Unbeatable. That's what I'd say. Unbeatable. You know, you really don't need to be going to any other conference. It was absolutely amazing. Like the presenters, I've got to admit that I didn't see as many presentations as I would have liked to have done, but I did see a lot, and they were all absolutely fantastic.
Yeah,
it's an unforgettable experience. Yes. Okay, well, we better get our next guest on.
And our next guest is Dan. Dan and I have worked on the advocacy committee together for the last year, I think it is. So I'm going to leave Dan to you. But Dan, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Niki.
Hi, how are you?
I'm doing great. And it's cloudy and cool in Wisconsin.
I love the fact that everybody comes on and announces the weather. It's such an English and British thing to do, talk about the weather.
I think it's great. I'm just relieved that it's cloudy and cool somewhere else and not just here. Okay, well, Dan, just a little bit about you for people that don't know. As well as being a former police officer and a martial arts expert, you're the owner of Happy Buddha Dog Training, and you're an accredited professional level dog trainer. You're also the chairman of the Pet Professional Guild Advocacy Committee. So lots of strings there to your titles. You've got lots going on. And I'm going to be asking you about a few different things, but mainly to do actually with you being a former police officer and some of the skills that you may have from that, and also with your role on the PPG Advocacy Committee, if that's okay, Dan.
Sounds good to me.
Yeah, perfect. Okay. Well, my first question is sort of quite generic in a way. I just want to know what actually drove you to become a force-free professional, because with your background, you know, you wouldn't necessarily think that you would go in that direction. So what drove you to become a force-free professional?
Well, back in 1983, my wife and I got our first puppy, a Labrador named Samantha. And I had no clue about raising a dog, didn't know anything about training. So I bought a popular training book, and it described the many ways of punishing a dog. And not knowing any better, I used those methods, but I didn't like the results or the way it affected my relationship with Samantha. So I put the book away, and then years later, after we'd had four or five Labradors, I became interested in training, and I was very motivated to help other people avoid all the mistakes I made. And it was pretty clear to me as I started studying training and behavior that force-free methods were the way to go.
Yeah, and that's actually a route that many people have taken, isn't it? That they've started off, you know, perhaps because they, through a lack of knowledge and because of the information out there, that they've started off using forceful methods and then realized that, you know, there is a best way. So, great. Okay. You are now a certified professional trainer accredited through the Pet Professional Accreditation Board. Can you tell us about the credential, please, and why this qualification was so important to you?
Well, I'd love to. My first certification actually was CPDT, and I was quite disappointed with the ease of the examination, and that even after being certified, I was still lumped together with people who were using punishment and aversive methods. I sought to distinguish myself in some way, and I saw PCT as a higher standard. Niki invited me to join the pilot program, which was quite an honor, and I decided to take the test cold, meaning I didn't study or prepare for it, and I sat through the entire three-hour exam in one evening while my internet service was fading in and out. But I did it that way because I wanted to determine by some objective measure whether I truly knew what I thought I knew in my daily work with dog clients. And by the way, I do recommend studying and preparing for the exam.
Yes, it's a tough exam, isn't it, Dan?
I found it pretty challenging, and it was also very rewarding. And one of the things that I found valuable was it helped me identify deficiencies in my own knowledge, so I knew what I needed to focus on.
Yes, that is actually a really good point. And I think having taken the exam myself, I know that although very challenging, it really makes you think about, okay, yeah, right, well, perhaps I need to look at this a little bit more. It really does, it makes you focus. It is a great accreditation. Okay, well, why do you believe some dog owners and even many professionals, for some reason, I'm not sure, but why do you believe that some of them actually have a preference for I'm going to say, punishing unwanted behavior rather than rewarding the favorable behaviors? Why do you think that some so-called professionals are still taking totally the opposite route to the route that we choose to take?
That's a really excellent question, and I'd love to see some research on that. In my opinion, living in the United States, we have a punitive society, and I think we still rank number one in terms of incarcerating the highest percentage of our citizens. In my 30-year police career, that put me smack dab in the middle of a system that actively sought out unfavorable behavior and initiated the punishment process. As a child, I grew up hearing the word no, and that was usually followed by punishment. I'm also aware that we have a very litigious society, and whenever something goes wrong, we always seem to look for someone to blame. So I think as a society, we've been conditioned to look for and to punish unwanted behavior, and that would influence professionals too. As far as the average dog owner, I think most pet owners lack the understanding of learning theory or classical and operant conditioning, as I can certainly attest from my experience with our first puppy. So to a typical pet owner, punishment may seem to resolve the problem because it inhibits the behavior. Because they don't understand the science of training, it does not occur to them that their methods are flawed, and so they blame the dog. And this is only made worse by certain popular TV shows and traditional advice from friends and family. One of the things I really appreciate about PPG is that we strive to educate and inform pet owners so they can avoid all the mistakes I made with Samantha using punishment.
Yes, it's a really good point, actually. PPG does an amazing job at getting the information out there and, in effect, empowering people so that they've got the knowledge, so they don't have to use those methods, and so that they can actually recognize as well when the dog is feeling uncomfortable, because I think that's a big thing, that people that use these methods, the forceful methods, the punishment methods, and they see that they work, but what they don't see is the side effects that the methods have on their dog.
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay. So we've just mentioned PPG, and I'd like to know, actually, what made you decide to take on the demanding role of chairman of PPG's advocacy committee? Because I know that you work really, really long hours, and you put a lot of work into this. So what made you decide to take on the role, Dan?
I'm going to be interested to hear this answer too, Dan.
Well, in July of 2014, I was granted membership in PPG. And I had already been planning in my own mind a campaign to ban shock collars in Wisconsin. And I was going to seek out the help of the Wisconsin Assembly. So I began collecting studies and data on the subject. And I wrote a letter to Niki, and I kind of explained my goal, and I was seeking support, thinking, oh, this is an organization that might be helpful. And a few months later, Niki responded and invited me to join the new advocacy committee and asked me to be the chair. So I kind of set myself up for this. And how could I decline?
Exactly. She said, laughing.
So basically what you're saying is that Niki didn't give you any choice, really.
That's about it, yeah. But, you know, it's really, I've learned so much from her, and a lot of the initial ideas I had, such as a legislative ban, I think I've set those aside because I'm realizing it really is a consumer issue. They're hearing a sales pitch from people that profit by them. They don't know what the consequences are. They don't really know how to use them. They're just looking for a solution to a problem. And it really is about educating and informing pet owners so they know what the options are. And when people have that information, they tend to make a better choice.
Yeah, so would you say that's one of the key goals of the Advocacy Committee, to actually inform people and to educate?
It is, and I'm going to refer back to our first advocacy, and I'm going to stumble on the term now, Advocacy Committee meeting. We talked about setting goals, and the key goal is to reduce and eliminate the practice of using shock devices in pet animals by 2018. But lately, we've also talked about eliminating pronged and choke collars, which would suit me just fine. Our strategy to accomplish that is to identify best professional practices, educate and inform pet owners and professionals alike, and to align key organizations around scientific data to support our goal. And all of this, and one of the main things I appreciate in Niki's approach, is that we have to be professional and respectful while adhering to the PPG guiding principles. So we can have an intelligent conversation about this without getting caught up in personal attacks and that sort of thing.
Yeah, that's you know, it's, yeah, I'm so glad to hear you say that, because I think there's an element out there that thinks that the Pet Professional Guild is very judgmental and sort of scathing and intolerant, and that's actually not what PPG is all about, whether it's the organization in general, whether it's the Advocacy Committee. You know, I mean, the three words that I use over and over again is engage, educate, and empower. And we can't do that if we don't have credibility, and we can't develop credibility if we don't develop trust, and we don't, you know, influence people in a positive way. So I think, you know, everything about PPG is about education, and it's about trying to influence people, and to do that, we need to develop credibility. And we need to find common goals. And, you know, one of the things I talk about in my book is that we need to negotiate with people. We need to negotiate based on interest. We need to find areas of mutual interest. And in that way, it's not an adversarial relationship. It's about finding common ground and building on that. And I think Dan mentioned one thing, which for me is very powerful, and Dr. Susan Friedman talks about it all, in terms of this cultural fog of, you know, it's always been done like this, so let's continue doing it this way, even though it's completely inaccurate and unscientific and in some cases not humane. But we need to give pet owners and other pet professionals the benefit of the doubt that they don't know any better. And if they do know better, they will make better choices, both for themselves and for their pet. And we can't access them. We can't facilitate that transfer of knowledge if we are antagonistic or if we're overly critical. So I think, you know, the same with the Advocacy Committee, it was very important to us as a committee that, and we've got some really great plans that we're rolling out next year, which Dan's not going to be able to talk to, and nor am I, because they're sort of heavily under wraps at this point, but we do have some really nice plans, we've got some exciting plans, but it will all be around what we should do. And one of the comments I made at the summit is that we don't have to convince everybody that our way is the right way, we just have to persuade them enough just to have them try. Because more often than not, when people try and they get the results, then that knowledge transfer takes place. So that's one of the sort of pinnacle points that the Advocacy Committee will operate around next year in terms of the goals that we're rolling out.
Great, Niki. Thanks for that extra information there. Dan, you mentioned, obviously, choke collars and shock collars. I know that PPG is actually gathering signatures in an online petition to show corporations how the pet owning community and pet professionals feel about the sale and distribution of training aids that can physically and mentally damage our pets. Can you explain why PPG takes such a strong stand against the use of shock collars for anybody that, you know, doesn't know the effects that they might have?
Absolutely. There are numerous studies that have shown that the use of shock devices offer no advantage in training, and they can cause functional harm as well as impede the learning process. These aversive methods cause fallout, which you mentioned earlier, such as learned helplessness or aggression. By contrast, our force-free methods have been shown to produce excellent training results without the fallout. Based on that, I see no logical reason to continue using shock and other aversives when there are effective and humane alternatives. And in my personal opinion, I think to do so is best unethical and at times even abusive.
I totally agree. You made a good point there, actually. You said the use of these shock collars can actually cause an increase in aggression. And I think that's something that everybody should realize, that they may think that they're using this collar and that it's going to sort out their problems, but actually they could end up with a much, much more serious problem.
Yes,
would you,
and it's
really... Would you agree with that?
I do, and it's pretty heartbreaking. One of the dogs I met a few months ago had a bite history, and the family took the dog to a trainer that uses aversive methods, and after that experience, the dog continued biting, but the bite severity was much worse. It was really a pretty frightening experience. And I couldn't even work with the dog. It was so hostile. I had to refer to someone else, and I'm really skeptical about the outcome because so much damage has been done. And in all likelihood, dogs like that end up being euthanized. And it's unfortunate, but that's the consequence of using punishment with dogs that have fear-based aggression.
Yeah, that's right. Very, 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 very sad. It's and it's something that could be totally avoided if these methods and these devices weren't used. Just horrendous, horrendous. Okay, I'm going to change my type of question slightly. You do a lot of work educating people about personal safety, and I think this probably comes from your former role as a police officer, but also I know I've read anyway that you're a martial arts expert, which is very, very impressive. Can you tell us some of the ways in which pet care professionals can make sure that they stay safe when they're out, for example, visiting clients? Maybe, you know, they get a phone call from a new client and they're going out to see somebody. What are some of the things that you'd advise?
This is a topic I could rattle on about for several hours, so I'll try to be concise. During my police career, I was very concerned about protecting people, and I studied the economic, social, and psychological causes of violence, and I saw an awful lot of data identifying women as the primary victims, and many of them were caregivers and were more easily targeted by typically men who were abusive and violent. As a professional trainer, I see most of my colleagues are women, and most would probably identify themselves as caregivers. And the nature of offering training lessons, and privates in particular, put women trainers in a position where they might be isolated. So this concerned me enough that last spring, I put together a training safety course in Wisconsin for a number of trainers that I'm associated with called Happy Buddha Jitsu. And in preparation, I wrote a handbook and produced a DVD to distribute in addition to the class. And the materials in this course were all based on police experience and martial arts training and a women's self-defense course that my wife and I and other volunteers offered for several years. So it occurred to me that dog trainers possess many skills already that are required for safety, such as keen observation skills, understanding of body language, interpersonal communication, the ability to plan, and having good timing. I applied all of these same skills as a street cop and basically had to defend myself on occasion. And I think a lot of these apply directly to dog trainers as well. So if I could, I'd like to outline some of that.
Yes, absolutely. Go ahead, Tom.
So I think the first thing is, to use a driving analogy, we may have all learned how to become defensive drivers, or at least those of us that are good at avoiding accidents are probably defensive drivers. And you can have the same approach, I think, to life, defensive living, or in your career as a canine professional. So the first thing I think of is being fully aware of one's surroundings, planning ahead and being proactive. Whenever I responded to a police call, and very often it was a situation that was already out of control, I thought about all the various things that could go wrong, and while I was responding to the situation, I was planning all the different contingencies that might be useful. And I never entered a situation unless I first identified an exit strategy. If I was going to schedule a private training session or meet a new client, for instance, I might let others know in advance where I was going and when. And there's actually some modern technology that can be helpful. There's a phone app that I just downloaded called Emergency, E-M-E-R-G-E-N-S-E-E. And with this app, you could set it up to create a list of emergency contact individuals, friends or family or police agencies. And with the push of a button, you could begin recording and streaming live video of the person that you're interacting with. So if you found yourself in a dangerous situation, you'd suddenly have a whole support network that would be able to send you help. There are other devices that I found just doing a little bit of web research. Another thing I would recommend is when you're interacting with people, just as you probably developed really good skills at the subtle body language changes in dogs that might predict a change in behavior or aggression, people display very subtle signs too. So I encourage everyone to rely on their instincts. If you feel awkward with someone, there's probably a good reason for that. But our social conditioning might have trained us to ignore those things. We don't want to be judgmental. We don't want to jump to conclusions. But many times, if we feel frightened, there is a good reason for that fear. And one book I would recommend is called The Gift of Fear. It was written by Gavin De Becker. I believe his name is spelled G-A-V-I-N, last name D-E-B-E-C-K-E-R. And he was a psychological profiler for the FBI. He wrote The Gift of Fear as a help primarily for women to avoid becoming victims of violence. And it's a really excellent, affordable book. Another thing I recommend is that if you're in a risky situation, don't be afraid to turn around and leave. Just because you made an appointment with somebody doesn't mean you have to go ahead and push through the appointment if you don't feel that you're safe. You could make escape or avoidance your first priority, and if you're not able to get out of the situation, then it becomes necessary to use some kind of force. And here's where I think force-free trainers might be at a bit of a disadvantage, because we probably have made a conscious decision not to use force. But I call it unleashing the beast. So if you're in a situation where you're given no other options, that's the time to act. And if you're not motivated to use force to protect yourself, then I'd ask you to consider, what would you do if your child was endangered, or how would you protect your dog? If you're willing to defend your child or your dog, then why not defend yourself? And there are certainly some excellent training options. I prefer Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu or Muay Thai or classes in mixed martial arts if you want to learn the physical skills involved. And there's one thing I'd like to finish on. A 10-year study on violent crime against women. It was released in 2004. It looked at thousands of cases, and it identified, and I'm going to quote here, the most effective combination of self-defense is fleeing, loud assertive vocalization, and forceful resistance. What they found was that when women used those methods, when they actually physically fought back, they were able to stop the attacker without any greater risk of injury to themselves. So I think this is about informing, educating, and empowering people as well.
That's really great information, Dan. I'm actually going to convince you, if not now, next time we talk. I think this warrants or could be a really good article for Barks and or maybe a short educational webinar for PPG members. I think you have a wealth of knowledge that we need to get out there to our community.
I would love to do that, and I'd like to make an offer as well. I mentioned the training booklet that I wrote. I call it the Tao of Happy Buddha Jitsu. It's 32 pages of practical self-defense. I wrote it specifically for dog professionals. So I talk about some of these principles about awareness and so on, and then I use stories from my police experience where I illustrate how to actually apply these things.
Mm-hmm.
There's no charge for this. I copyrighted it solely because I didn't want anybody else to get a copy and then produce it for profit. But I could distribute this through email as a PDF file. So anybody who's interested could simply contact me and then I'll send them a copy of the self-defense booklet.
Wonderful. And that self-defense booklet might make a really nice handout or supportive document to a short webinar as well.
Right. I think it's actually pretty easy to follow. I do have some information in there on anatomical targets, so that if someone does have to use force, there are effective and ineffective ways to do that.
Right. Yeah. Excellent. Okay.
But I would recommend
that. I think a webinar would be great though as well, Dan. I think what Nick is saying, you know, you've just given us sort of a real, if I was to sort of sum it up, you said be proactive, be fully aware of your surroundings, let other people know where you're going. You've mentioned some emergency apps, which you actually gave me the links for, so we can make those available as well. Rely on your instincts, don't be afraid to sleep. But you could sort of expand on that so much. I do think, we're going to have to push you a little bit, and the offer of the booklet is absolutely amazing, but I think a webinar is definitely called for.
Yeah, I think a webinar is a great learning environment because, you know, I know from the school I run that a lot of people are not interested or just don't find the time to read, but if you can sit them down on a webinar for 20, 30, 40, 50 minutes, you can access them and get that knowledge out there. Perfect. I will make it my mission, Dan. I will make it my mission to get you on a webinar.
That's it. He's got to say yes now. Let's face it, you managed to get him to be the chairman of the PPG Advocacy Committee, so I think we'll manage this one, Niki. Thank you so much, Dan.
Well, thank you. It's been great fun.
That was brilliant. How can people get in touch with you, Dan?
Well, there are two easy ways. You could go to the Happy Buddha Dog Training website, and it's all one word, happybuddhadogtraining.com, and I do have a contact form there, and I can give you my business email, which is happybuddhatraining@gmail.com. Buddha is spelled B-U-D-D-H-A. There's different spellings of that, I'm sure, but anybody who wanted to contact me could just send me an email and I can send them a copy of that PDF self-defense booklet.
Thanks, Dan. And that'll also
That's
be a hot link to Dan.
The one will be getting one.
Yeah, and when the web...
Sorry,
when
Nick,
the,
what did you say?
When the podcast goes up of this show, there'll be a hot link as well to Dan's website.
Sounds great.
Perfect. Perfect. And something else, actually, before Dan goes, Niki, that I could perhaps ask you. We mentioned, well, I was asking Dan about his accreditation through the PPAB. Can you give us a little bit more information if anybody wants to learn more, Niki? How can they find out more if they're interested in doing the exam?
Okay, well, there is a link on the homepage of the Pet Professional Guild, which is petprofessionalguild.com. But PPAB is actually an individual company, and the Pet Professional Accreditation Board, and the website is credentialingboard.com. There's a lot of information on there about the examination. The examination is just one component of the accreditation program. There's also videos required for mechanical testing. And then for the dog behavior consultant accreditation, there's also case studies as well. But it's a psychometrically developed certification for professionals, so it tests against a common body of knowledge that was developed. There is a very detailed study guide there, so if you download the study guide, that gives you a lot of information about the examination. It's 250 questions. It is much more, it is more difficult than the other exams that are out there. It can be taken from your own home. It's invigilated through webcam, which means you don't have to drive anywhere, so you can do it from your own computer. So it's just a great program, and you know, one of our taglines is stand up for what you believe in. So I think it's the only credential that is available to people that you don't have to be a PPG member. Anyone can apply to take the examination, get the credential. But what you do have to do is agree to the guiding principles and the ethics, because it is a credential designed for transparency in our industry and consumer transparency and animal welfare, and then obviously professional integrity. So there is an eligibility criteria that you have to meet before you can actually apply. But yeah, credentialingboard.com is the website, and there's a lot more information there. And if anyone has any questions, they please email us, and we'll happy to answer them.
Thanks, Niki. That's great, because as Dan said, it's definitely a credential that is worth having. If you get that credential, you've earned it. But not only that, it speaks volumes. Just as you just said, it lets everybody know that you are abiding by PPG's guiding principles, which I think is so important.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Dan. And sorry that we've overrun, as usual, but thank you so much for all that great information.
So
okay.
I think,
Niki.
Yeah, before we bring Jill on, I just wanted to, one of the sponsors that was at our summit that is sponsoring PPG World Services is Blue Nine Pet Products. They have a great product out there called the Climb. These got snapped up like hot cookies at the summit. They are now a PPG preferred vendor, so PPG members do get a discount off all purchases, and to get your discount code, you'll have to log into your account and go to the PPG membership area. And just a heads up, Michelle Puglio is doing a live webinar on January the 15th about platform training in dogs. So if you watch that webinar and enjoy it and decide it's something that you want to get involved in, then the Climb is the platform that you will need. So I put a little bit of information on here as well about Michelle's webinar. So basically, learn how to effectively use a tool from a platform master. The presentation is sure to provide any trainer with several light bulb moments about great ways to use these platforms in their training programs. So there you go, Blue Nine Pet Products. The product is called the Climb. So visit their website and have a look at some of the great products they've got there, which will also support the webinar on January the 15th. So back to you, Lou.
Cool, thank you. Well, we've now got Jill on, hopefully. This is Jill Breitner. Hi, Jill, are you there?
I'm here. Hi.
Hi, Jill. Welcome to the show.
Hi, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. It's so lovely to have you on the show. And just to let everybody know, Jill's actually an expert on canine body language, and she developed the Dog Decoder app. And that probably doesn't need a lot of explanation for a lot of people, because I'm sure many, many people are aware of it. But I'm going to ask you, Jill, could you actually tell us, for those people that don't know, what is Dog Decoder?
Dog Decoder is an app that I authored to teach people about dog body language, what dogs are trying so hard to tell us. And it's done in a really accessible way. So what I mean by that is that it's a scenario that as trainers we see pretty much every single time we go out to an appointment. So I had to limit it. I chose 60 of the most common scenarios that we deal with as dog trainers and put them into a scenario and then described the information and then described all the dog parts that are talking. So there's three images per scenario, and there's 60 images. So that means there's 180 images. So if we don't, as a culture, we don't really understand what dogs are trying to tell us, then we're in trouble because injury happens, dog bites happen, people are hurt, dogs are euthanized. And both the presenters before have spoken to this, so I just felt like it was really, it's a tool that we could use today because everybody has their phone with them rather than having to worry about a video to watch or carry with them or a poster. It's right there.
That's right, and actually a few people have actually said that to me, that they're using the app and that they find it really useful. They've got it there on their phone and, you know, they can get pictures out, they can show it to clients, so it's a really good resource. What actually inspired you to create the Dog Decoder app and why? Well, you sort of touched on this. I was going to say why an app, but what inspired you to create it?
Well, I've been doing this for 40 years now, and I think that observation is the key to anything. We need to have the methods and things to really understand what dogs are doing and how to work with them, but if we're not in observation 100% of the time of the owner, of the dog, of our situation when we're working, then we're missing out, and I think that enough people were bitten, enough trainers are bitten, enough people are bitten, and the thing that inspired me to actually wake up at 2 in the morning and say, I'm just done with this, this didn't need to happen, was Kyle Dyer is a newscaster on the Denver Morning Show, and she was bitten by a dog on the show, and so what happened was, and it's the warning sign, on the image on the app, they were doing a Good Samaritan show on a dog who ran out after a coyote onto a lake in Denver, and the coyote fell in and the dog fell in and the owner called for help. A fire department came out. They rescued the dog and everything was on video, and then the video was taken off. But before it was taken off, they showed the rescue. And when they put the dog down, when the firefighter put the dog down on the ground, the dog slinked away and kind of did this, you know, look away, indirect look, slinking tail down, rounded body, and I knew that that dog was an aggressive dog. And he was, you know, clearly, don't come near me again. It was, you know, I'm out of the water, don't come near me. And they decided the next day, in less than 24 hours, to do a Good Samaritan story on their show. No one checked out, the owner checked out the dog. The dog was now, I think the dog went to the vet to make sure that he was okay. But they brought the dog on the show the next morning. 45 minutes or so before the show, he's in the studio and people are all over the dog. So he was completely traumatized by falling in the lake, being rescued, going to the vet. Hopefully he went to the vet. And then now on a TV show. And the show, he's sitting in between, they had the firemen there, the owner, the dog, and the dog in between the dog, the owner's legs, with the owner holding his collar. And the newscaster, Kyle Dyer, is all over him, and he's giving every single signal he can to her, any more, any closer, and I'm going to bite you. And the owner knew it, and the minute she got too close, the owner just tightened up, you can see it in the video, tightened up that you may not even, the normal person wouldn't even have seen it. I saw him tighten up and the dog bit her in the face on the air, and she's got blood and she takes off. And that's when I thought, ah, enough. The world has seen that one. That was all over until they took it off. And I thought, how can I do this? How can I make this happen so that people are not continually being bitten by dogs? When the dog told her for a good 5 solid minutes, stop, leave me alone.
I can actually remember seeing that. I don't know whether I've seen it on YouTube or perhaps on Facebook or something, but yeah, I can remember seeing that, and yeah, so true. The dog made every attempt it could to communicate, you know, back away, and unfortunately nobody listened. Yeah. Who is the main target audience then for the app?
Everybody. Anybody that owns a dog, anybody that loves a dog, anybody that works with dogs. So I'm teaching at vet hospitals their whole staff how to read dogs so that they don't send their staff to the ER room because they're dealing with a fearful dog and holding it down or trying to just get a muzzle on it and bitten in the process. Shelters, I would like to see it in every shelter and sanctuary around the world so that people understand what dogs are trying to tell us. Parents. It's in children's museums that we're looking at getting it into the school curriculum in elementary school. You name it, if you have anything to do with dogs, it can benefit you.
Absolutely. And for those of us that know, we obviously, there are a lot of us out there that do understand that canine communication plays a massive role in helping to prevent injuries inflicted by dogs. But if you were to sort of say to people, how would you sum up, how can our understanding of canine communication help in preventing injuries?
Well, if you understand, even when you're just training a dog, even when you're bringing a dog from the lobby back into the exam room, if your dog is nervous, and you don't understand that, or you do, let's say you do get that your dog is nervous, but you don't really understand the signs, you're just kind of getting a subtle general, my dog seems uncomfortable, and then you're uncomfortable. The dog senses your lack of confidence, and therefore the dog is going, oh man, she's uncomfortable too, now I'm even more uncomfortable. And so it progresses, that you know, the dog is now being triggered into a little higher arousal of fear or anxiety. And when you don't know that, how to read that, and you don't know what you're doing can affect that, or another person approaching your dog and how that can affect your dog, then both you and your dog and everyone around you is in danger, because any dog can bite. Did I answer your question?
So true. Yeah, that's something that you did, and that's something that I tell people quite a lot. Any dog can bite. They've got teeth. They can bite. Yeah. Do you think understanding canine communication is important then for the average, I'm going to say, pet dog owner? Can it create a better relationship with a family pet?
Oh, absolutely. I have if you can't speak their language, you can't really truly bond. You have a relationship, but the bond is much deeper when you actually can speak their language. So it's a nonverbal form of communication that we have between them. And in order to effectively train them to have them as members of your family, understanding what they're trying to tell us is crucial in your bond, in your relationship with your dog, just as a family pet.
I totally agree, and dogs do such a great job at understanding our communications. It's very sad in a way that many people understand very, very little of what their dogs are trying to tell them. Yeah. On your website, you state that your philosophy is laugh and teach, which I think is great. But in what ways can we make sure that our interactions with our pets are fun?
Oh, a ton of ways. I think dogs actually, when we pay attention to them, we're training them, we're interacting with them. They're goofballs. They're funny. They're kind of, I call them like the coyote, the muse, the trickster. They want to make everything into a game. Everything is into a game. So if you see them coming in life that way, a dog comes to you and how, let's play, then training is play. So instead of, I used to say play, train, play, and now I just say play, play, play. Because if you're making a game out of teaching sit, out of a recall, out of not being destructive in your house, out of how to behave with other dogs, how to behave with children, and it becomes a game. You give a child a treat, and the child asks the dog to sit, and if the dog knows it, the dog is so excited to sit for the treat from a two-year-old with the proper guidance and supervision of a trainer and a parent teaching the body language at the same time. So your dog is happy, or you asked him to sit and he's not that comfortable. See, he doesn't want the treat. He won't take it from you, and he's looking away. So if we can change that and really just see that if who they are and how they come to the world is let's play, then how can we not laugh and teach?
Definitely, and I totally agree with you. I think all training should be fun. It should be a game. That's exactly what it should be. It should be fun for everybody involved. Yeah. You talk a lot on your website about being a leader. What do you mean by this?
Being a leader means having the leadership skills to understand conditioning, operant conditioning, counter conditioning, timing, the subtle nuances of what motivates a dog, of how to approach a dog, of understanding body language, theirs and yours. It's having the skills and the knowledge and the experience to show up as a leader and then use those things in training as a game, in play.
Brilliant, nice answer. I asked you that question because obviously leader is one of those words that's sort of thrown about and sometimes doesn't have great connotations, but that's a fantastic way of explaining it. Why do you think it's important to use positive science-based, rewards-based force retraining?
Because it works. And it keeps the dog motivated, it keeps the dog happy, the tail is wagging, ears are forward. There's compliance, there's willingness. When you use something that is an aversive method, and you know, 40 years ago when I first looked into doing this, you know, I was trying to read some books and find something. The Keeler method of training was the only thing that was out there, you know, Rin Tin Tin's trainer. And I looked at that and thought, that's not going to work for me. I tried it, it just didn't feel right. And I also work with horses, and you can't muscle a horse. I can't beat a horse up and tell them this is how we're going to do it. I physically couldn't do that. So a dog is a predator and a horse is prey, and if you allow an out, if you allow a horse that to go out, if you allow a dog to show us it's uncomfortable and then reinvent yourself and try to create a way where the dog wants to be willing to work with you, then there's no reason to use anything but being force-free, but using treats, using a ball, using your hand for praise, using verbal praise. What game can we play? What ignites this dog? And there's no reason to use anything else. When you look at, I would love to talk to Daniel about it, and I will contact Daniel. When we talk about banning shock collars or prong collars, there's no studies done, and how can we do a study on what a dog looks like when it's being trained with aversives? So who would we use to, you know, as that subject? But I think if we can get out and videotape different trainers and have a side-by-side, same thing being taught with aversives, same thing being taught without aversives, the body language of the dog will clearly speak for itself. And I think that may be one way to engage our community of dog professionals in teaching the world in masses, which is why I developed the app, because it's not just in our world, it's I can hit the world globally, dog lovers globally, to realize that this is, it doesn't work. The dog speaks for itself. It doesn't work.
No, that's right. I think actually, I don't know whether Dan's still there. Dan, could I ask you, I believe that there are an awful lot of resources actually on the Pet Professional Guild's website. Are there any studies that have been done, Dan?
There are quite a few resources, and I actually just sent a few more to Susan Nielsen, the editor of Barks, and she's developed this great database on the PPG website. But I could certainly share the studies that I have stored on my computer. I've probably got 30 or 40. There are studies on the effect of aversive methods and shock training in particular on field dogs and that sort of thing. And I've heard of some side-by-side video comparison. I don't know where the source is offhand, but I've heard some conversation about that. So I think somebody might already be doing that. It's a great idea.
Yeah,
thanks,
there are
Dan.
A lot of yes. Sorry, there are studies, but I don't know. I haven't seen the side by side, and I think that would be really effective.
Yes, right. No, definitely. I think. Well, Dan, you've probably got more information, but you just mentioned actually that Susan Nielsen has put together a great resource on the Pet Professional Guild website, which is all the past articles from Barks and also the blogs that have been done and lists of resources, etc. So anybody who wants more information can go onto the website and they can have a look at that. And as you said, Dan, you've got, I think, have you got the actual links to the articles, or could you make them available?
There are, Louise, there is a page in the members area that does have a lot of scientific article links on it as well.
I thought there was, Niki. Yeah, thanks for putting in there.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And there's also a few articles on the advocacy page on the website.
Perfect. So maybe you want to have a look on there as well, Jill, because there may be some things that you haven't actually seen that might be of interest to you.
Absolutely. Thank you.
But I know in the member area there's a couple of pages that have a lot of links. Leah Roberts did a really good job of collecting all that type of information, and Leah was a steering committee member. For those of you that remember, she died a couple of years ago of cancer. But Leah, we have a foundation fund for Leah, which actually supports and sponsors our advocacy efforts. So all the information that Leah had collected was transferred over to the PPG website, so there are a lot of links there.
Yeah, and there's also a lot of work being done in the UK at the moment. One of the steering committee members from the Pet Professional Guild British Isles has been very involved with a campaign to get shock collars banned in Scotland, which at the moment is just going through Parliament. So, you know, I know there's quite a lot of information out there, and there are probably, you know, other studies that are perhaps UK-based rather than USA-based, but that have been done. And it looks like, in Scotland at least, it looks as though, you know, they're seriously considering banning shock collars, and that is on the back of the research that they're, you know, looking into. So there obviously is a certain amount of research and studies that are being done. Okay,
yes,
so
I'm aware
that was actually, yeah, cool. That was actually my last question. So before we go, I'd like to ask you though, how can people get in touch with you, learn more, how can they find out about the Dog Decoder app, where can they download it, etc.?
You can find out more on dogdecoder.com. That's the website. You can also get the app from iTunes, from the App Store, and from Google Play.
That's brilliant. Thank you so much for joining us, Jill. And I apologize sincerely for having taken up so much of your time, because I know, as usual, we've run over. But everything that everybody else was saying has sort of been linked to what you're saying. It's been a great show because the information is just really pulled together there. So thank you.
Thank you, Jill. Thanks for joining us.
Here, thank you. And yes, we're all linked and we're all doing this together. So I appreciate all the effort that everybody puts into doing this. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you to you too.
Okay.
Okay, Niki.
Well, Louise, this is the last time we will talk in 2015.
Oh my gosh, and hasn't this year flown by? Before you know it, we'll be back at the summit again.
I know, the next show will be in 2016, and 2016 is going to be a fabulous year for Force Free Training, for PPG, for all the education, for everyone that supports and sponsors us, for all our members. I just have a really good feeling about 2016, so it's going to be a very exciting year. So hopefully, well, not hopefully, because, you know, hope isn't going to make it happen. We are going to make it happen. We're going to make sure that PPG World Services gets bigger and brighter. We've got some great guests coming on next year. We're going to have some great things to announce to everybody. Yay! So I'm going to wish everybody...
Hang on one second, Niki. Before we go, I'd just like to let everybody know that on the January 3rd show, so that's as soon as we get into the new year, we've got a show, January the 3rd, the first Sunday of the month. We've got Teresa McEwen, we've got Diana Nichols-Pepper, and we've got Yvette Van Veen coming on. So that looks like being a great show as well.
Excellent, excellent. Well, I want to wish everybody a fantastic holiday season. I hope that everybody has time to spend with their pets and their friends and their family and to celebrate everything they've achieved and to look to the great future that is coming around the corner for our industry and for everything to which we work so hard to bring about. So thank you to everybody. Have a fabulous holiday season and a fabulous new year. And we look forward to talking to you next year in 2016.
Yay, thank you. And thank you, Niki, for everything that you've been doing.
You're so very welcome.
What can we say? Happy Christmas and Happy New Year to everybody.
Yay! Have a great holiday, everybody. Talk to you soon and stay safe.